Hello friends, I am Dr. Arvind Arora. I am taking orthopedics classes on Unacademy platform. Today, in this YouTube lecture, I will be discussing recent orthopedics questions which have been asked in NEET 2020 last Sunday only. And in my next YouTube lecture, I will be discussing orthopedics question of NEET 2019. So, after those two lectures, we will be assessing the trend in orthopedics from which chapters the examiner is asking question these days. So before going ahead, I will request you, if you would like to subscribe Unacademy, you can use this code Arvind Arora 11-6036. So you will get 10% discount on all subscriptions. Okay, so I will start recent questions and trend analysis with those questions. So these are NEET 2020 orthopedics questions. The first question which was asked in NEET 2020, a 30 years female patient is presenting with wrist pain on lateral side. On examination, Dikwar vein tenovaginitis is diagnosed. Dikwar vein tenovaginitis involves tendon sheath of which two muscles? Abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. Abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis longus. Abductor pollicis brevis, extensor pollicis longus. Abductor pollicis brevis and extensor pollicis longus. So here the answer is abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. These two have common tendon sheath which is inflamed in Dikwar tenosynovitis or Dikwar tenovaginitis. Yes, Saurav? Okay, I'll tell you. I'm working on that. I'll tell you. Okay, so Dikwar tenovaginitis involve fibrous sheath thickening or tenovaginitis of abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. So the pain is at radial styloid level, lateral side of the wrist. Now to diagnose Dikwar vein tenosynovitis, we do Finkelstein test, in which we ask the patient to make a fist with thumb inside the fist and we forcefully do ulnar deviation. The patient will be feeling pain at radial styloid level if he is having Dikwar vein tenovaginitis. Okay, Saurav, I will do that also. Those will be there, I think, in February or March. And treatment of Dikwar vein tenovaginitis is rest and anti-inflammatory. If patient is not improving, then local injection of corticosteroid. Even if patient is not improving after injections, surgical decompression of tendon sheath is required. However, most of the time, conservative management is successful in more than 95% of the patients. Okay, so this question was direct repeat from previous year questions of NEET. So we will also see which questions are repeated. So this one question was repeated. They have made it clinical question long one rather than one liner. Now the second question was, 36 years old male is presenting with pain in small joints of hand and morning stiffness. The given deformity of hand is seen. The diagnosis in this condition is rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, psoriatic arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis. Yes, Mani Balan, Saurav, what is the answer here? What is the answer? So here you can see flexion at distal interphalangeal joint and hyperextension at proximal interphalangeal joint. So this is swan neck deformity. Characteristically seen in rheumatoid arthritis. Okay. So this is swan neck deformity seen in rheumatoid arthritis. Other deformity which is seen in finger is hyper extension of distal interphalangeal joint and flexion at proximal interphalangeal joint, known as Bottonius deformity, that I will be showing you in next slide. Here you can see in the question there is morning stiffness. So this is inflammatory type of pain. Osteoarthritis is mechanical, non-inflammatory. Okay, so this cannot be the answer. Now these are the deformities in rheumatoid arthritis. In swan neck deformity, there is hyperextension at proximal interphalangeal joint and flexion at distal interphalangeal joint. In Bottonius deformity, there is, okay, so I will tell you the difference between mallet finger and swan neck. Let see, Bottonius deformity is flexion at proximal interphalangeal joint and extension at distal phalangeal joint. Now how will you differentiate mallet finger with this swan neck deformity? In swan neck deformity, there is hyperextension at proximal interphalangeal joint, whereas in swan neck deformity, it will be either normal or slightly flexed. Okay, it will not be hyperextended. Here in swan neck deformity, proximal interphalangeal joint is hyperextended and distal interphalangeal joint will be flexed, both in mallet finger and swan neck deformity. Understand? So this is swan neck deformity. In Z deformity, there will be ulnar deviation of fingers and radial deviation at wrist level, looking like a Z deformity. At elbow, there will be flexion, and at knee, there will be flexion, and later there will be triple deformity. Triple deformity, components of triple deformity are flexion of knee, posterior subluxation at knee joint, posterior subluxation of tibia, and external rotation of tibia. Okay, so these are the three components of triple deformity, and all these deformities are due to, all components are due to contracture of iliotibial band. And important causes are, important causes for these triple deformities are RA, then poliomyelitis, and tuberculosis of knee, tubercular arthritis of knee. These are the three important causes for triple deformity of knee. In ankle, there will be equinus in rheumatoid arthritis. In feet, there will be hallux valgus and hammer toe. In hammer toe, there is flexion contracture of proximal interphalangeal joint of second to fifth toe. In hallux valgus, this distal part of the great toe will be deviating away from the midline, and interphalangeal joint will be towards the midline. That will be hallux valgus. So these are the deformities in rheumatoid arthritis. In osteoarthritis, due to overgrowth of osteophyte distal interphalangeal joint, there will be Havarden node, and at proximal interphalangeal joint, there will be Bouchard's node. Mnemonic for that is high definition blood pressure. Havarden node, distal interphalangeal joint, Bouchard's node, proximal interphalangeal joint. Okay, and E, in knee, there will be varus deformity, as you can see, because osteoarthritis is mechanical disorder, wear and tear due to repeated mechanical stress. And normally, mechanical axis of knee in normal person passes just medial to midpoint. That is why there is more degeneration of cartilage on medial side. Therefore, there will be varus in osteoarthritis. Now, the third question was, in a 53-year-old male patient, distal interphalangeal joint, proximal interphalangeal joint and first carpometacarpal joints are involved with sparing of wrist joint and metacarpophalangeal joint. The diagnosis is rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, hemophilic arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis. Yes, Saurav. Yes, what is the answer here? Uma is saying Subramaniam. Uma Subramaniam. Yes, osteoarthritis. Very good. Involvement of distal interphalangeal joint, proximal interphalangeal joint. Doctor, trending is B. Very good. You are also right. And first carpo metacarpal joint. Now it is very important to know the distribution of hand joints in rheumatoid arthritis and osteoarthritis. So you remember five joints which should be distributed between these two disorders are distal interphalangeal joint, proximal interphalangeal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint, first carpo metacarpal joint and wrist joint. Okay, so this is the figure. Distal interphalangeal joint, proximal interphalangeal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint, first carpo metacarpal joint and wrist joint. We will have to distribute these five joints between osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. So I will tell you how I remember this. O in osteoarthritis comes before rheumatoid arthritis alphabetically. O comes before R. So first these two joints I give it to osteoarthritis. Distal interphalangeal joint and proximal interphalangeal joint. Now I will eliminate this joint. Next two joints I will give to rheumatoid arthritis. That is proximal interphalangeal joint and metacarpophalangeal joint. The next joint, that is first carpo metacarpal joint, I will give it to OA. And the next joint, wrist joint, I will give it to RA. Now, in OA, there is involvement of distal interphalangeal joint and proximal interphalangeal joint along with first carpo metacarpal joint. In RA, there is involvement of proximal interphalangeal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint and wrist joint. Okay, now metacarpophalangeal joint and wrist joints are spared in OA, whereas distal interphalangeal joint and first carpo metacarpal joint are spared in RA. So you should remember this is very important. Okay, and here are the three most important joint disorders. You should understand joint distribution in these disorders. First, most common joint involved in osteoarthritis is knee, followed by distal interphalangeal joint. Remember, some guides have given distal interphalangeal joint as the answer, which is incorrect. Osteoarthritis more common in weight bearing large joints, especially knee joint, followed by small joint distal interphalangeal joint. So this is the distribution most common. In rheumatoid arthritis, most common joint is metacarpophalangeal joint. In ankylosing spondylitis, it is SI joint, most common involved. Now, which joints are involved in osteoarthritis? Distal interphalangeal joint, PIP joint, first carpo metacarpal joint. Metacarpophalangeal and wrist joint are spared along with elbow joint. In lower limb, hip and knee are involved, ankle is spared. And in spine, cervical and lumbosacral regions are involved. And whenever we are using term spondylosis, cervical spondylosis or lumbar spondylosis, that means we are talking about osteoarthritis of spine, nothing else. In rheumatoid arthritis, in hand, proximal interphalangeal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint and wrist joints are involved. DIP joint and first carpo metacarpal joints are spared. In feet, metatarsophalangeal joint and IP joint, interphalangeal joints are involved. In large joints, knee, hip, shoulder and elbow are involved. And in spine, there is particularly involvement of upper portion of cervical spine, which can lead to atlantoaxial dislocation. Ankylosing spondylitis is a disorder of axial skeleton. Most common SI joint, followed by spine, then costovertebral joint and shoulder and hip. Peripheral small joints of hand and feet are spared. Okay, so this was the distribution of joints in important disorders. Now this second question, which was direct repeat from previous year. If 50 years old female is presenting with insidious onset of low back pain, X-ray of spine is showing following image. The diagnosis is osteoporosis, Paget disease, osteopetrosis, osteogenesis imperfecta. Yes, Dr. Trending, Dheeraj, Dr. Denning say, hey, yes, osteoporosis, very good. It is osteoporosis only. Here you can see, yes, it is fish mouth or cod fish vertebra, biconcave vertebra with biconvex disc. Yes, Subramaniam, yes, it is osteoporosis. So it is cod fish vertebra or fish mouth vertebra. Remember, the most important cause of fish mouth vertebra is osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, okay, most important cause. Second important cause is osteomalacia. Then primary hyperparathyroidism and hemoglobinopathy like sickle cell anemia and thalassemia majors. So these are the important causes of fish mouth vertebra. Now all the given options are very important from radiological point of view. So first we will see important radiological findings in vertebrae or spine, then radiological finding of each disease separately. In Paget disease, there will be three manifestations in skull, three radiological features. One will be osteoporosis circumscripta, one will be cotton wool skull, and the third one will be TAMO center sign. In spine, there will be picture frame vertebra and ivory vertebra. There will be blade of grass sign and brim sign. That I will be showing you the X-ray also, just I am telling you the name. In osteoporosis, there is diffuse sclerosis with obliteration of medullary cavity, armillary flask deformity, and bone in bone appearance, okay, along with sandwich vertebra. So first look at various important radiological features in spine. If all four borders of vertebra are sclerosed like this, this is picture frame vertebra seen in Paget disease. Okay, if upper and lower border are sclerosed but they are not clearly defined, this is Rugger Jersey spine seen in secondary hyperparathyroidism of renal osteodystrophy. Now similar to Rugger Jersey spine is sandwich vertebra, where upper and lower borders are sclerosed but these are more dense and clearly defined. This is sandwich vertebra and this is seen in osteopetrosis. Okay, in osteopetrosis. So remember, in osteopetrosis there is no Rugger Jersey spine, there is sandwich vertebra. This is ivory vertebra, full vertebra is sclerosed and dense, ivory vertebra. It is seen in Paget disease, tubercular infection, lymphoma, especially Hodgkin's lymphoma, sclerotic or blastic metastasis like prostate and neuroblastoma in children, or primary tumors of vertebra like osteoblastoma. So these are the causes of ivory vertebra. Now this cod fish vertebra we have already discussed. Osteoporosis, osteomalacia, hyperparathyroidism, sickle cell anemia and thalassemia major. This is bamboo spine, large segment of spine is united by bridging syndesmophytes. This is known as bamboo spine. There will be calcification along supraspinatus and infraspinous, supraspinous and interspinous ligament known as Dagger sign. And with this Dagger sign calcification, there will be calcification of apophyseal joints in spine. This is known as trolley track sign. All three are seen in ankylosing spondylitis. Bamboo spine, Dagger sign, trolley track sign in spine are seen in ankylosing spondylitis. Now this is bullet shaped vertebra. It is a feature of achondroplasia. Okay, so these are the important radiological finding of spine. Now about radiological findings of given option. In Paget disease, there will be blade of grass sign. You can see this is osteolytic area, wedge-shaped osteolytic area looks like blade of grass or candle flame, known as blade of grass or candle flame sign. There will be large area of osteoporosis, osteoporosis circumscripta. All four borders are sclerosed frame vertebra. Full vertebra is sclerosed. Radio density in full vertebra, ivory vertebra. Thickening of iliopectinate line, known as Brim sign. Anteroposterior increase in size of skull, tam of Shenter sign, because it looks like tam of Shenter cap, Scottish cap. There will be cotton wool skull where there is fluffy calcification between outer and inner diploid of skull vault. So these were the radiological finding of Paget disease. Now quickly, radiological finding of osteopetrosis. There will be diffuse osteosclerosis, cortical thickening with obliteration of medullary cavity, unlayer flask deformity in which there is metaphyseal flaring and diaphyseal constriction causing unlayer flask deformity, sandwich vertebra which we have discussed, and bone in bone appearance. Okay. Okay, Dr. Trending and Sorum, I will give you answers of your question after finishing my lecture. Okay, so let me continue this. Okay, I will give answer of your questions. Okay, so the next fifth question in this NEET was Limburger sign is seen in scurvy, rickets, hyperparathyroidism, osteomalacia. Yes, everyone, tell me what is the answer here. Limburger sign is seen in yes, Dr. Rending, it is A, scurvy. So important radiological feature of scurvy are no tuma, it is scurvy. Pencil. Okay, doctor, this was not there. So yeah, this was given to me by one of the student only. That is why I am discussing. Okay. Pencil, thin cortex, ground glass appearance of bone. White line of Frenkel, metaphyseal white line, tremor filled zone, that is zone of radiolucency below the white line of Frenkel, Pelkan spur, prolongation of white line, and the most important one, Limburger sign or Limburger ring sign, ring shaped epiphysis. I will show you the x-ray also. In rickets, there will be splaying, cupping, splaying and fraying of metaphysis. So look at metaphysis. In hyperparathyroidism, the most important classical radiological finding is subperiosteal bone resorption of phalanges on radial side, on one side, not both side, on lateral side. That is the characteristic finding. There will be salt paper skull. There will be loss of lamina dura. There will be osteolytic lesion due to brown tumor. Okay, that I will be showing you in the x-ray also. And in osteomalacia, there will be pseudo fractures or Milkman fractures, triradiate pelvis, protruso acetabuli, and codfish vertebra. So now I will show you the x-ray. This is the x-ray of scurvy. Pencil thin cortex, you can see here. Here, this is ground glass appearance of bone. This is white line of Frenkel, and lateral prolongation of this white line is known as Pelkan spur. This is tremor filled zone, radiolucent area below white line. And this is Limburger ring sign, ring shaped epiphysis. Okay, this was x-ray of scurvy. Now in rickets, copying and spraying of metaphysis with spraying of metaphysis. Irregular, not clearly defined metaphysis, because there is irregular mineralization, defective mineralization. So in rickets, you look at metaphysis, and when you are suspecting scurvy, first look at epiphysis. There will be ring shaped epiphysis, and metaphysis will be clearly defined due to this white line. Okay. Now this is the, these are the X-ray findings of hyperparathyroidism. Salt and paper skull, as you have sprinkled the paper on the salt base. See, you can see small osteolytic area like paper on a salt base. There is loss of lamina dura, thin bone in the socket of tooth. You can see here it is lost. Here you can see white bone, clear. Here it is lytic area. Loss of lamina dura. There is subperiosteal bone resorption of phalanges on one side, mainly on radial side. This is pathognomic. In spine, there will be codfish vertebra due to osteoporosis. And due to brown tumor, there will be expansile lytic lesion in the bone. So these were the radiological findings of hyperparathyroidism. One finding which is not given usually in the book is rotting fence appearance. When there is slipped capital femoral epiphysis due to hyperparathyroidism, the proximal end of femur look like a rotting fence post. So this is rotting fence post appearance in hyperparathyroidism. In osteomalacia, there are loser's zone or milkman's fracture, triradiate pelvis, triangular pelvis, protruso acetabuli, where acetabulum along with the femoral head protrudes inside the pelvis. If it is bilateral, it is known as otopelvis, and codfish vertebra, which we have already discussed. So these were the radiological findings of given options. Now this was the sixth question. In kyphosis, degree of deformity is calculated by which of the following method as shown in the image? Cope's method, Hamburger's method, Holden's method, Milkowski brace. Yes, Saurav, what about brown tumor? What do you want to ask about brown tumors? Yes, Saurav, what do you want to ask about brown tumor? Yes, it is Cope's method. So some of the students were saying that it was scoliosis in the question, and some were saying it was kyphosis. Whatever it was, the angle, the severity is measured by Cope's angle only. Yes, Prashant, very good. So severity is measured by Cope's angle. So to calculate angles in scoliosis and kyphosis, you should know. Okay, brown tumors, I will tell you. Let me finish this question. I will tell you what is brown tumor. I will tell you. Just let me finish this. So to calculate Cope's angle, you should understand two terms. One is end vertebra, and the other one is apical vertebra. In a curve of scoliosis or kyphosis, the uppermost vertebra, which is maximally tilted. See, this vertebra is maximally tilted. Now the tilt has, here the tilt has reduced. So the uppermost vertebra, which is maximally tilted, is known as upper end vertebra. And similarly, the lowermost vertebra in the curve, which is maximally tilted, that will be the last vertebra in the curve, that is lowest end vertebra. Okay, so line along the upper border of upper end vertebra and line along the lower end of lower end vertebra makes an angle known as Cope's angle. So with Cope's angle, we know the severity of scoliosis as well as kyphosis. Now there is one other method, that is Ferguson's method, where you should know apical vertebra also. Apical vertebra is the vertebra which is maximally wedged in the concavity of the curve, and which is least, which is in the center, therefore it is least tilted, almost straight. So you make a center point in the upper end vertebra, in the lower end vertebra and center of the apical vertebra. Then draw two lines from the upper and lower end vertebra to the center of apical vertebra. The angle which is formed, Ferguson angle. This is the other method to calculate the severity of curve. Now Cobb's angle has been asked twice or thrice. They can ask Ferguson method also. Okay, so remember Ferguson method. Okay, so this was the next question. A patient is diagnosed with biceps tendon rupture. On examination, following image is showing. What is the sign? Wimberger sign, Pope's sign, Greenwood sign, or Williams sign? Yes. Very good. Even if you don't know the answer by looking at the image, you can see the comic character Popeye, the comic character of Popeye. So you can make the diagnosis. Biceps has two heads of origin. Long head arises from supraglenoid tubercle. Short head arises from tip of the coracoid process. So this long head is intra-articular, passes through the joint, through bicipital groove of proximal humerus, and maintained in place by transverse humeral ligament. If there is rupture of long end of biceps, this part will get retracted and produce a bulge known as Popeye's sign. That is why this part of the muscle is also known as Popeye muscle. Okay. So here I will tell you some tests for biceps muscle. One is Jergensen's test. The other one is speed test. And the third test is hook test. Now remember, the Jergensen test and speed test are for bicipital tendinitis, not for tendon rupture. That is inflammation of long head of biceps. In Jergensen test, you ask the patient to flex the elbow 90 degrees, fully pronate, and ask the patient to do supination against resistance. And simultaneously, you will be palpating in bicipital groove. If there is popping out of the long head of biceps, that means transverse humeral ligament is injured. Or there is, if there is no popping but there is pain, that means there is inflammation in long head of biceps. Similarly, in speed test, you ask the patient to do 90 degree of shoulder flexion and full elbow extension, and you press downward and ask the patient to resist this. There will be pain in bicipital area. That signifies bicipital tendinitis. So these are the tests for inflammation. Now this hook test is for rupture of biceps tendon distally. Okay. So these are the tests. Speed test, 90 degree, shoulder flexion, elbow extended, you press and ask the patient to resist. In Jergensen test, 90 degree elbow flexion, full pronation, you ask the patient to supinate against resistance. Patient will be feeling pain in bicipital groove area if there is bicep tendinitis. Now this is hook test. You try to put finger below the biceps tendon from lateral side. Normally, if biceps tendon is intact, you can insinuate the finger up to distal interphalangeal joint if tendon is intact. However, if there is rupture of distal part of the tendon, you cannot insinuate as there is no tendon overlying. So this is hook test. You are using your finger like hook. So this is for rupture of distal part of the tendon. Now the next question was extension deformity at metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion deformity at interphalangeal joint is due to paralysis of lumbricals and introcii, extensor digitorum communis, flexor digitorum profundus, and extensor pollicis brevis. Yes, lumbricals and introcii. It is nothing else but claw hand. Okay, it is nothing else but claw hand. So claw hand is due to paralysis of lumbricals. Now here you can see extension at metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion at interphalangeal joint. This is claw hand. It is due to paralysis of lumbricals. Normally, lumbricals cause flexion at metacarpophalangeal joint and extension at interphalangeal joint. If there is paralysis, there will be opposite deformity. In ulnar palsy, there will be claw hand of medial two fingers. This is ulnar claw hand. And in combined median and ulnar palsy, there will be complete claw hand, like in clump case paralysis. Now you should remember that there is nothing like isolated median claw hand. In isolated median nerve injury, there will be no claw hand of these two fingers because introcii are also spared. Those are supplied by ulnar nerve, and introcii have their assisted action to lumbricals in flexing the metacarpophalangeal joint and extension of the interphalangeal joint. That is why in isolated median nerve palsy, there is no claw hand of these two fingers because sparing of introcii. However, if both ulnar and median nerve are damaged, introcii are also paralyzed. That is why there will be complete claw hand. Now, there is ulnar paradox. Normally, what happens? Proximal the nerve injury, more the muscles paralyzed. There will be more deformity. However, in ulnar nerve, if injury is at wrist level, there will be claw hand. But if injury is at elbow level, higher level, there will be no claw hand because flexor digitorum profundus is also paralyzed, which is supplied by lateral medial half is supplied by ulnar nerve. Okay? Yes, Dr. Tending, very good. All intrinsic function need to go if there should be claw hand. Very good. So, ulnar paradox means higher the lesion, less the deformity. That is the paradox. Now, this was the question. A 30 years old patient is presenting with knee pain and swelling. On biopsy of the lesion, there are giant cell and mononuclear cells. Most probable diagnosis is giant cell tumor, osteosarcoma, osteochondroma, and Ewing sarcoma. Yes, very important. Yes, very good. All of you are giant cell tumor. Giant cell along with mononuclear cells, these two types of cells are seen in histopathology of giant cell tumor. The histopathology is very important. Here you should know these giant cells, which are derived from osteoclasts in giant cell tumor, are not the neoplastic cells. Okay, not neoplastic cells. These mononuclear spindle cells are the neoplastic cells. Okay, that is why giant cell tumor is considered as a misnomer, because giant cells are not the neoplastic cell. These mononuclear cells are the neoplastic cells. I will show you the histopathology. These are the giant cell derived from osteoclast, and these are multiple small mononuclear cells, spindle cells. So these spindle cells are the proliferative component or tumor cells in the giant cell. Okay, not the multinucleated giant cell. Now the other option whose histology is very important to understand is Ewing sarcoma. It is small round blue cell tumor. That is why on histology you will find so many small round blue cell due to this enlarged nucleus, scant clear cytoplasm. These cells contain glycogen granules and glycogen is stained by PAS. So these are PAS positive. Glycogen is metabolized by diastase. So these granules are diastase sensitive and sometimes they form Homer right rosettes. Okay. So the next question was, if 3 years old child is lifted by her maid by holding the wrist of the child started crying. Yes, age of the child will be less. Child started crying and was not moving her elbow. The most likely diagnosis, pulled elbow, radius fracture, Galeazzi fracture dislocation, Montagnier fracture dislocation. Yes, this question is also repeated. It has been repeated so many times. Typical history of swinging the child by holding the wrist in extended and pronated position. Child starts crying and presenting to you with pronated hand and extended elbow. Typical pulled elbow or nurse-made elbow, that is subluxation of, yes, Uma, Prashant, Dr. Trending, Suryakant, Shubhanshu, Saurav. Yes, Saurav, the previous answer was GCT, giant cell tumor. All of you are correct here. So it is pulled elbow or nurse-made elbow. Most of the time, child is between the age of 2 to 5 years. And head of the radius pulled partly. So there is subluxation. See, there is subluxation, not dislocation of radial head. And typical history is longitudinal force in pronated and extended elbow by lifting and spinning the child. The child starts crying due to pain, not moving the elbow. Forearm is pronated and elbow is extended. X-ray will be normal and the treatment is simple. Just start flexing the elbow, supinating the forearm and give posteriorly directed force to reduce the radial head. And it will be reduced immediately. Okay. So this question is repeated so many times in your NEET exam. Now the final question was, the drug of choice for the treatment of postmenopausal osteoporosis is estrogen, bisphosphonate, teriparatide or calcitonin. Yes, what is the answer here? Yes, Uma, Prashant, Subhanshu, B, Dr. Trending, Prashant is B. Yes. So, yes, so all of you are right. It is bisphosphonate. So, drug treatment of osteoporosis, you can divide into two types. Anti-resorptive drug, which reduce the bone resorption by osteoclast. They target osteoclast and reduce bone turnover. And anabolic therapy, which target osteoblasts, stimulates osteoblasts to increase bone formation. So, it is bisphosphonates because estrogen has its adverse effects. So, that is why some of the time we are using hormonal replacement therapy depending on the presence or absence of uterus. Okay. So, that is not the drug of choice for osteoporosis. Specifically for osteoporosis, bisphosphonates are used. Okay, so anti-resorptive therapy which decrease resorptions are bisphosphonate, which are taken up by osteoclast and they induce apoptosis of osteoclast. So they reduce bone resorption by inducing apoptosis of osteoclast. Donisubimab is antibody of RANK ligand. It binds to RANK ligand, which stimulates differentiation of pre-osteoclast into osteoclast. So donisumab inhibit this differentiation of pre-osteoclast into osteoclast. Similarly, estrogen and selective estrogen receptor modifier like raloxifen also decrease or inhibit RANK ligand mediated differentiation of pre-osteoclast into osteoclast. Calcitonin inhibits osteoclast to decrease bone resorption. Now this teriparatide is recombinant parathormone containing amino acid 1 to 34. Normal parathormone, natural parathormone has 84 amino acid, 1 to 84. So this recombinant one has 1 to 34. And it is very interesting to know, though parathormone is resorptive hormone, parathormone normally in the body induces resorption of the bone. However, intermittent therapy with recombinant parathormone only induce osteoblast, not the osteoclast. So it leads to bone formation. This is the only available drug commonly used in osteoporosis, which is anabolic therapy. Okay. Strontium is the other drug which has both effect, but nobody is using strontium. Nobody uses strontium for osteoporosis. It is just for theoretical purposes. It reduces both bone resorption as well as it induces bone formation. Okay. So these were the orthopedics questions. Total 11 questions were there. And I think one of you are saying that Wimberger sign was not there, then it was only 10 questions from orthopedics. Okay, so anybody wants to ask anything regarding these questions? Saurabh, you are saying need 15, 16, 70 multi-session have to be done. See, if you can finish, that will be very good. But at least last 3 years paper should be done for need. Okay? For all subjects, at least 3 years topics should be covered. Whatever topics are there. Last 3 years topics, you should master those topics. Okay? Joint rib type, Saurabh, which core joint was there? What was the question? Saurabh, what was the question, beta? Doctor training, what was the question, beta? Okay, so let me find out the question. I have all 290 questions with me in my diary. So I will find out. So most probably I have left that question by thinking that will be covered in anatomy. So in my next YouTube lecture, that is on Sunday, I will see that question. Okay, Saurabh, you are saying elastic cartilage, fibrocartilage, or hyaline cartilage. Okay, this question was there. Yeah, so I have left that for anatomy. But don't worry, if you want, I will cover that with slides also in next YouTube lecture, which is on Sunday. So on next Sunday, I will take out all those questions which are related to orthopedics from anatomy. I have 290 questions with me. Okay, so I will take out those questions with joint one also and cartilage one also. First rib and sternum. So, okay, someone is saying that is sternum. Someone is saying the students gave me the question, according to that answer was synovial joint. But let me see the question once again. I will come with the proper question as well as answer in my next YouTube lecture on coming Sunday. Okay. With that, one of the joint one and one is for cartilage. Okay, Saurabh, Dr. Trending, Sunday YouTube lecture, I will be taking same time and I will cover those two questions also. So first, let me find out from my diary what exactly the questions were. Okay. Anything else? Okay, so thank you very much for joining here in my YouTube lecture. Please do subscribe if you are interested on Academy platform, and you can use my code, which is ArvindArora11-6036. You will directly get 10% discount. Okay. Okay, so I will be taking next lecture on Sunday, same time. Okay, So thanks everyone for joining me here, and I will clear all your doubts with those two questions also, and I will also be discussing last year 2019 questions of orthopedics. After that, we will be analyzing which all topics and chapters are important for orthopedics entrance exam, from entrance exam point of view. As you saw in these 11 questions, no question were from traumata part. No question were there for trauma part. All were from bone, tumor, joints, all cold orthopedics. Okay? So there is misconception. Trauma is most important. Orthopedics means trauma, fracture, dislocation. Nothing like that. From PG entrance point of view, other topics are more important than trauma. I'm not saying trauma is not important, but other topics are more important. After discussing next lecture 2019 questions, we will be analyzing the trend also. Then I will tell you which topics you should read in orthopedics more frequently. Okay, you want me to discuss rheumatoid treatment of rheumatoid arthritis also? Trauma, say there was one question only, that biceps rupture, but even that we don't usually teach in our lectures. Biceps tendon rupture, usually nobody teaches. Now it has come, we will start teaching that. Okay? So next lecture, I will tell you the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis also. So I will remember three things from Saurabh and Dr. Trending. One is question on cartilage. The second one is question on joint, synovial or whatever the joint was. The third one is treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. Okay? Chalo. Now I will finish my lecture. Thanks everyone for joining the lecture. Thank you very much and best of luck for your preparation.